There is another thing which disturbed me while talking to you. The museums in India, you told me, the governments hire exhibition designers or entertainment event management companies. They set up museums and curators like you are hired by them and you have to report to these people. So, I mean, it is very sad that the professionalism is not coming. Like in Goa, there's a customs museum here. There's a customs building, is one of the old buildings, a blue building, a beautiful building. I went in there, horrible, it has been converted into a museum. They have made a kind of a thing where you scan your luggage in an airport, a replica of that with cardboard figures. Now, it's an insult to that building. It's done very, very unprofessionally, and I was told that it was done by wife of some director general of customs somewhere. So, professionalism, making museums and making them, I mean, engaging professionals.
You know, it's, yeah, absolutely right. The fact that I managed to achieve 1,60,000 visitors to my exhibition, I don't want to sound ungrateful, but the truth is that this was achieved against many, many odds.
Okay.
I had a supportive member in Brussels. I had one really supportive person helping me, the Director General of the National Museum, Dr. Venu Vasudev, helping me in Delhi. Were it not for the will and the drive of two helpers, this would never have happened. But the success of this exhibition has been against every possible odd that was there working against us. The extent of visual illiteracy and apathy in this country, the training of our museum personnel and their exposure, the motivating factors for what they consider good taste, the absence of knowledge of history and aesthetics in their training has cost us so severely in our country that the losses are something that if we were to really sit down and do a quantitative financial analysis, we would come up with ridiculous figures of what we are potentially losing out on every day in this country. And you look at it by contrast when you go into certain other countries and you see the extraordinary nature of how they have become visually acute, harmonious, balanced, intelligent, and the way in which museums, displays, city planning, etc. is worked out. And you see how art and culture permeate the very fabric of our country. And India, paradoxically, is the land which is supposed to pride itself on its cultural heritage and fabric. And yet we are in the most appalling condition in our country with the greatest amount of visual illiteracy in India. This is the paradox. Unless we are able to address these crises very urgently and with an active policy to make a change in culture, we're going to be doomed as a nation.
Why do you think it happens? For example, we are a country which created Ajanta Ellora, Khajuraho, Elephanta, the great temples in Puri. So we have done great work of international standards, of great standards in the ancient times. But my contention is for the last quite a few hundred years, we have not created anything which is sort of that standard. Perhaps, in my opinion, the last great public kind of sculpture of this kind happened in Hampi, and that is already 400 years ago.
I think you're being too harsh. I think you're being too harsh. I think wonderful things have been done. But they are few and far between. I mean, after all, the city of New Delhi was designed and Raisina Hill and the town planning of Lutyens Delhi was is one of the great achievements of how the public interfaces with the city. We have great new cities being built. They're very clever. But I think some of the lessons to be learnt from urban planning have been forgotten. Everything is being centered around the two-bedroom hall kitchen, the grand southern secretariat building that is going to be built, certain very showy public spaces, mm-hmm. but for actually for where is the park, where is the museum,
mm-hmm.
where is the place that the people will get spiritual mm-hmm. or intellectual mm-hmm. sustenance,
mm-hmm.
those things need to be folded into the project.
Mm-hmm.
The fact that the city needs to look beautiful
mm-hmm.
and inspiring at every corner that you turn
mm-hmm.
should be something which is sufficiently harmonious mm-hmm. that keeps you thinking mm-hmm. in a certain way.
Mm-hmm.
That level of thought is really missing.
For example, we created Ajanta Ellora, we created all this, but today of this works of this kind of not happening. So the kings of Ajanta Ellora,
well, you know,
they chose well.
There has been
mm-hmm.
a very sad and very substantial amnesia.
Mm-hmm.
that has taken place.
Mm-hmm.
I think because people don't engage with mm-hmm. history,
mm-hmm.
with our past, with, you know, you have a great wardrobe.
Mm-hmm.
It isn't made in a day.
Mm-hmm.
You might have a suit that you picked up
mm-hmm.
from somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody has a sari that she got at her wedding.
Mm-hmm.
She added another one that she got from her mother.
Mm-hmm.
She adds another something mm-hmm. on some other mm-hmm. particular occasion.
Mm-hmm.
And by the time she's a middle-aged lady, she has a fantastic array of saris in her cupboard which have been built up over a long period.
Mm-hmm.
Some things are very traditional, some things are very fashionable, some things are modern, some things are old.
Mm-hmm.
Things are built up.
Mm-hmm.
Cities, memories, people, visual mm-hmm. acumen is mm-hmm. built up.
Mm-hmm.
In India, we have suffered very badly
mm-hmm.
because government policy has not made art and visual literacy
mm-hmm.
as a part of how people are meant to think.
Mm-hmm.
Simple things, you know, how quickly you can make a change.
Mm-hmm.
People have, photographers have been doing experiments, giving mm-hmm. these days photography costs nothing.
Okay.
Everyone has a digital little mm-hmm. camera in their phone.
Mm-hmm.
They set up photography compositions, contests.
Mm-hmm.
Every kid with their mobile phone was busy taking pictures and submitting them.
Mm-hmm.
What it immediately did was allowed the teachers to give feedback to the students about compositional frames, about color balance, etc.
Mm-hmm.
Basic things about knowing how to look
mm-hmm.
through a frame.
Mm-hmm.
You don't have to go to the Film Institute to mm-hmm. necessarily be taught how to compose a basic frame.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you just need to go out there, use your phone, mm-hmm. start using a 16x4 format yeah. or whatever you're using mm-hmm. and start
mm-hmm.
composing.
Mm-hmm.
That ability, mm-hmm. that practice-oriented
mm-hmm.
work,
mm-hmm.
that has not been happening enough
mm-hmm.
in the country.
Mm-hmm.
And unless people start actually doing things with
mm-hmm.
their hands,
mm-hmm.
with their eyes,
mm-hmm.
and be made to think mm-hmm. and look,
mm-hmm.
that looking isn't happening enough.
Okay.
And there are many innovative ways that it can be brought back
mm-hmm.
into society.
Mm-hmm.
And I think indeed your Ajantas and Taj Mahals and all and Elloras will be back.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think yeah. they'll go.
No.
And I'm okay. sure we'll do better.
Yeah. Okay, going back a little bit, I mean, I talked about Ajanta Ellora. The choice of those kings is still valid. But today, somehow, the choice of when making public art is basically done by our politicians who have no background in choosing good art because they are not exposed to. Perhaps the kings of Ajanta Ellora had a background, a few generations of exposure to art, and then they chose well. The today's politician has no background, neither the bureaucracy. So the chief secretary will choose a sculpture, the chief minister will choose a sculpture. So there is not a curator. So
well,
what kind of a structure is required to sort of ensure that there is some kind of a structure?
See, in defense of the civil servant,
yeah.
I have to say something.
Okay.
The appalling lack of education and the caliber
mm-hmm.
of some of our professional cadres,
mm-hmm.
whether it was museums or archaeologists, etc.,
mm-hmm.
was such that there was no choice left but for the civil service to step in and
mm-hmm.
save those institutions from ruin.
Okay.
I don't believe, I know a lot of my colleagues who are archaeologists and museum professionals
mm-hmm.
and curators will be very upset with me for saying such a thing.
Mm-hmm.
But the truth of the matter is
mm-hmm.
that the way in which the hiring
mm-hmm.
at those in those institutions has
mm-hmm.
been done
mm-hmm.
and the inefficiency and rot that has set into
mm-hmm.
our institutions for art and culture
mm-hmm.
in this country
mm-hmm.
is such that honestly, were it not for certain
mm-hmm.
important civil servants who
mm-hmm.
have stepped in
mm-hmm.
to save those institutions and to save our heritage, the heritage would never have been saved.
Okay.
Now, does that mean that the civil servant is adequately trained to be able to make the artistic choices that you're asking of? He's not. And I freely admit that. And that's when you need the cadres of the professional curators and archaeologists and others to come in and step in and make all the difference. In India, we haven't been able to make that bridge between the two. And I think the only way forward at the moment is that if the UPSC and other bodies like that were to make art history and art education a mandatory subject, or to make one of the entrance exams for the UPSC into a knowledge of art history, you immediately bring about a complete social change, because within 10 years, you will have district collectors scattered all over the country who have had an art and culture training. It used to be one of the most important things as a learning course for Indian diplomats. Foreign service candidates used to have very rigorous training. It's very embarrassing if the ambassador of your country goes to inaugurate a collection of Indian art in some foreign museum and doesn't know the first thing about what he's looking at. It becomes very embarrassing when you see particularly how every other country in the world seems to regard soft politics culture as an extremely important extension of its defense and economic strategies, apart from foreign policy, a part integrated part of foreign policy is. And India is a country where we live extraordinarily. We have one of the largest diaspora populations anywhere in the world. India doesn't live in India. India lives in Trinidad, in Mauritius, in Canada, in America. India lives in all of those places. How much is India interacting with those countries abroad? How is Indian culture being sustained and maintained? What is the relationship that they have with their motherland? Who is going to be the formulator of the culture policy of India when you think about all those arenas? And if we don't step in fast and start thinking about a multicultural premises, basis for looking at and displaying and thinking through Indian art, we are going to be in a crisis. So I really think it's very urgent that government begins to educate its own rank and file in the field of Indian art and culture, to tell the history in a different way.
You're right, very right, Naman. I think, well, it is wonderful talking to you.
Thank you.
And, well, when we look at this sculpture, which was made 2,000 years ago, I think the sculpture also looks at us. Thank you very much.
Thank you.